Kulbir, Singh, Bhaura, 1955.
When did you first pick up a hockey stick?
It was back in India. I guess it would have been the age of about 6 or 7. Can't exactly remember what age I was, but I can always remember playing hockey. Where I was born in Jalandhar, in India, our house literally overlooked the college grounds, the senior college grounds and the school, which was renowned for hockey in those days, Lalpur Khalsa College and Dwaba Khalsa School. They produced endless number of international players, namely Ajit Pal Singh. He's been one of India's best centre half in those days, well renowned. And so I had the privilege of actually growing up on a hockey field from as far back as I can remember. And in the evening, coming back from school, we used to have our school practice, and then we would stop and watch these senior international players playing for the college team, or they'd be practicing in the evening, and we would sort of, you know, just admire the skills. And one of, in fact, Ajit Pal Singh, he was my elder brother's class fellow, and they were in the same year. And so he often used to come around the house, and so we got to know him. Well, I got to know him, and then as I was sort of done, finished my practice, and then I would ask to say, well, please, can we play with you as well? And often they'd say, yeah, just go and stand at the back, and usually end up picking the ball up from when it went off the sidelines or the back lines. You never got anywhere near them. But it was just a privilege to be on the same pitch with them and watching them play. It what really enthused me, and I guess sort of took my career into hockey where it has been. And so the start of my sort of hockey days has been, you know, quite privileged, if you like. Yes. And then we emigrated to England in 1968. I was the age of 13. and my second elder brother, who's second in line, he was playing. He was already here. He came in 1966, 2 years before my mother and my younger brother and I, when we came. and he was playing at Indian Gymkhana Hockey Club at that time. And so obviously I sort of, you know, used to go with him and started playing at Indian Gym. And Indian Gymkhana again had sort of a lot of Indian players who had just recently come over from the Indian subcontinent, including Pakistani players, not just Indians, as well as African nationals. So I had I was sort of playing or started learning hockey with these sort of ex-internationals or had played at university level, and really superb players. So, you know, it really progressed at that time.
So did they let you play in team events at the age of 13?
Not at the age of 13. I used to practice with them, and I think probably about 14 or 15. My physique was kind of quite okay at the time, at the age of 14, and I started playing for the second team. They had two teams. There wasn't a league system at the time. It was just purely friendly matches, so it didn't really matter that much. And the second team always used to struggle with numbers, and so I always had the chance to play. So I started off in the second team, and by the time I was 16, then I was sort of getting my sort of chance in the first team, albeit not for a full match, but certainly I was getting sort of quite a decent pitch time. And at the age of 18, I went for trials for Middlesex, and I got selected to represent Middlesex at the age of 18.
Is that Middlesex schools or Middlesex, full Middlesex?
Full Middlesex, senior Middlesex squad. So, and Middlesex had it was one of the best counties for hockey in the 70s. You had sort of Southgate and Teddington and Hounslow, all the sort of international players used to play at those clubs, and they were selected for Middlesex. And for me to actually make the squad, Middlesex squad at the age of 18 with all these internationals, again, it was sort of, you know, really sort of heartening, and you know, gave me a lot of confidence.
What position did you play?
Well, I used to play for the club. I used to play centre forward, but I knew that getting centre forward position in Middlesex was tough because I can't exactly remember who was, but it was one of the international players was playing centre forward at the time. It might have even been Rolly Brookman. I think I recall.
He played wing for England.
Yes, he played right wing, but I have a feeling that he, at that time, he was for Middlesex. I think he played forward, centre forward, but I can't be sure. I'm just sort of just have that vague memory. I think that it might be him, and so I trialled right wing, and so I got selected to play there, and then after a couple of years, I got selected for the divisional side, the south of England, and that's where my career really sort of had a major turn, because Freddie Scott, who used to manage the Middlesex team, he was asking me to sort of come to Hounslow to join Hounslow Hockey Club, and that was because Gymkhana at the time, we were in the Southern Premier League and not in the London League. Mm. And to get recognition, to play against top class players, I really had to play in one of the London League clubs. And Hounslow was a very local club to me. And so I was persuaded to change clubs. I think I would have been the age of about 22, 23. And within 2 months of joining Hounslow, I was called up for the England squad, and that was 1979. Yeah.
Can you remember your first international match?
I haven't got great memory of. I know it was against Belgium at Crystal Palace, and it was a very exciting day for me. My parents came and watched. My brother, the whole of the Gymkhana club was there. but the match itself is a bit of a sort of hazy, is a bit of a blur. How I played, I can't remember, but it was just the excitement of the day sort of probably overwhelmed me. And I think I had a reasonable game. I'm not quite sure.
If you don't remember any disasters, then it probably was.
Yeah, I don't think there were any disasters. But certainly, it was a challenging, you know, so, yeah.
So were you then a regular in the England team?
Yeah. The funny thing was that I was regular. I had my first 8 caps. I'm not sure whether this needs to be aired. For first 8 caps under the Indian passport, because I had applied for British citizenship. And but I carried on playing. Well, I kept getting selected to play. I did tell the management that, look, I've applied for the British. They said, don't worry about it, it's just friendly matches. And then there was an international match against Germany at Lord's, and I got dropped from the squad. I think there was a full international, proper FIH-affiliated match, and I got dropped from the squad. And for the reason that I didn't have the British passport in hand. And so that was my only sort of ever having been dropped from the squad. But then I was back again within sort of a couple of months when I received my British passport. So then, yeah.
Any particularly memorable matches that you played in for England before you got selected for GB?
We had a tour to Australia in 1981, and that was a very memorable tour. We had 5 test matches against Australia and 10 state matches, and it was a 3.5 week tour, and that tour was what was the making of me, if you like. It gave me a lot of confidence, a lot of experience playing at that level. In a 3 week period, we were playing sort of almost every day or every other day, and against state sides and 5 international matches, 5 test matches, and I scored in a few of the state matches, and that's where sort of I sort of felt that I was getting sort of confident. And when we came back, there was we went to the World Cup in Bombay in 1982, and the opening match was against Holland, and we lost 7-2, and I scored the only 2 goals that England scored, and and that was the sort of, you know, the real kind of building confidence and sort of getting recognition from the management, and obviously hoped that the GB managers would be looking at it, looking at me. And it's a superb place to play, India and Pakistan, because they're so passionate. I mean, the crowds were just unbelievable. I never played in front of 30,000 people. You know, and I went to my that World Cup, and the, you know, people screaming their heads off, and it was just unbelievable, unbelievable experience.
So then you were playing for GB. Mm-hmm. You played against Pakistan in your first one.
Yes, yeah. So that was
in Pakistan or at home?
No, that was in Hong Kong.
Oh, yes.
We had gone there for a qualifier for the. The 1984 Olympics, and we had to finish in the top 2, I think we finished 6th or 7th, I think, in that tournament. We just did not have a good tournament, so which was a major disappointment, because that meant we were out of the Olympics for 1984. And as history would tell you, that we did go to 1984 Olympics, because Russia dropped out and came back with a bronze medal. So that in itself was just completely something different.
What are your memories of those Olympics? It's in Los Angeles, wasn't it?
Well, the most standout memory for the whole process getting to the Olympics was quite harrowing for me, and quite challenging. The selection process for the 84 Olympic was really tough for me. And so what had happened was that I didn't play that many matches in Hong Kong. I suppose I hadn't gained the confidence of the manager, and so I didn't get much pitch time. And because we didn't qualify, stopped training intensively, which you would do normally for major games like that. And when we got called up, we literally had 3 weeks preparation, or 3 or 4 weeks worth of preparation before we were due to go out to the games. And so I remember having our first training weekend, which would have been the selection weekend at Lillehammer. And we met on Friday evening, we trained quite hard, and then on Saturday again we sort of had our usual tests, shuttles and 2 mile runs and everything else, and then we played hockey. On Saturday night, Roger Self announced the team, just the first 14 players, not full 16 squad, and I wasn't in the 14, and so that was sort of, I was getting a hint that maybe my selection wasn't forthcoming, for that tournament. And then Sunday, just before lunch, after having finished a game in the morning, I was getting a little bit of feedback from a colleague of mine who played at Hounslow, Ian Thompson. And he was sort of feeding me some information to say Roger Self is not favouring you over Robert Clift and Mark Precious. But all the other coaches, David Whittaker and the rest of the coaching team, were favouring me. And so the reasoning for that was that Roger Self didn't feel that I was fit enough. And had the sort of the mental toughness to go to the Olympics, and I thought I'd proved myself in the European Cup, but prior to the Olympics in Amsterdam for England, I played inside right. I thought I had a very good tournament, and so did the coach, David Whittaker. But anyhow, he said that he wants to test my fitness before announcing the final two. So I did. I was made to do shuttles by myself, and Ellen Hargreaves, who was our fitness monitor at the time, he then suggested to Roger that it was unfair that only I did it on my own, my shuttle times. Why don't you test the other two as well? He suggested. And so Mark Precious and Robert Clift, they ran together. So when you're running with somebody, there's always that little competition comes into it, and you push each other, and you're so their time over the six shuttles was sort of 1 second faster for each shuttle than my time. So and then Alan Hargreaves said to Roger, he said, look, if he was running with them, I'm sure he would have gained a second on every shuttle. So therefore, all three are of the same time, and that all the times would have been the same, exactly the same. And I think that sort of put him in a situation where then he had to make a decision. All our three times were the same. And they went in for the lunch and came back, and before our sort of the next match, which we're due to play in the afternoon, practice match, he said Bhaura and Mark Precious are selected. So that sort of, I thought, well, so that's when I actually got my sort of real sort of, kick from it. So I thought, I booked my ticket now, so and now you can make me run as much as you want to. I've got my ticket. And sure enough, that's exactly what he did. We went to Europe. I think we went to Belgium and Spain to get some practice matches before we flew out. And all I remember is doing shuttles and sort of every opportunity. It just became a joke in the squad that Kulbir, get up, it's shuttle time. So yeah, so that was sort of it's a very kind of standout process for me in order to make the Olympics.
Yes.
And once we got to the Olympics, yeah, I mean your first Olympics, you walk into a stadium, sort of 60, 70, 80,000 people, never experienced as an amateur sportsman, you never experienced anything like that. And the sheer volume of the noise from the Americans, and they are loud at the best of time, especially for the Olympics, as we walked around the opening ceremony. I mean, it was just a phenomenal feeling. It was just your blood, your hair stand up in the back of your neck, experiencing that. So that was just something else. And I was just pleased to be at the Olympics, let alone win a bronze medal at the end.
Did you have big crowds from the Americans for the hockey? Because it wasn't a much of a hockey nation at that time.
No, I think the crowds were non-Americans in most cases. There weren't huge crowds. I guess 10,000, 15,000 probably would have been the peak, because the American team itself was sort of involved, but even they didn't get a huge audience. I mean, with men, it's not really that popular in America. It's mostly ladies. So
still
if the, yeah. So yeah, so there wasn't huge crowds. The stadium itself was very big, so it didn't feel sort of full capacity at any stage. Yeah.
And the progress to the semi-finals you must have reached.
In Los Angeles.
In Los Angeles, was that straightforward?
Looking back on it. Yeah, I mean, we surprised ourselves to be on top of the our group, a qualifying group. We, you know, prior to going to the Olympics, we used to be scared of the Dutch team and the Germans and the Australians. I don't know what happened in that tournament, where there was a lack, we didn't have sort of very long preparation. The whole thing just came together and we just kept winning matches. You know, the teams we would usually lose to, I mean, we lost our group match to Germany but we ended up in, qualifying for the semi-finals and from the semi-finals, it was the match against the Germany, which was the second time we played. We just didn't perform. The whole team froze. It was a new experience. We'd never been in that sort of position before. And I remember sort of in the team meetings that it was all very, players looked nervous. We all felt nervous, including myself. And when we actually played, it was probably our worst game of the tournament, and a game that we needed to be our best game in order to get to the final. And I actually didn't play that game at all, and because prior to that, it's I sort of every time Roger Self used to use me sort of very tactically. It would start off with Stephen Batchelor on the right wing majority of the time, and he would sort of get the defenders sort of ragged, you know, for the first half and sort of 10 minutes into the second half, and then I'd probably go on for the last sort of 15, 20 minutes and, you know, try to create sort of short corners, and that tactic used to work really well. But against Germany, I was sort of itching to go on, and we were losing the match. And for some reason, I didn't go on. And not if I had gone on, who knows what could have happened. I'm not saying we would have won the match, but it was just one of those matches. And then it came to our sort of bronze medal playoff against Australia, and I remember sort of at halftime we were 2-1 down, and. And Roger Self came up to me and he said, he used to call me Danny. He said, Danny, just go and play whatever you want to play. Meaning that if you want to play centre forward, then ask Sean to go inside right. And if you want to play inside right, then go there. So, which was totally... was a surprise to me, because, you know, somebody who wasn't prepared to sort of take me to the Olympics in the first place, to give me the sort of the decision process to say you can either, you know, go centre forward or inside right. And I said, look, I'll start inside right and then I'll see how it goes. He said, fine. So I started off the second half inside right, and I wasn't getting anywhere. And about 10 minutes into the second half, I said to Sean, I said, can you come inside right and I'll come centre forward, and we switched. And all of a sudden, the whole thing started to work, and we sort of created short corners and ended up winning, as you know, 3-2.
Yeah.
And I remember Roger Self coming off the bench straight over to me after the game. I could just see him darting towards me. And we just hugged. And I just burst out in tears, broke down. The emotion, the build-up to the Olympics and the selection and the whole sort of... it was just an amazing feeling at the time, I just couldn't handle it. I just won the bronze medal, and wasn't going to make the Olympics in the first place, and here I was, sort of the guy who wouldn't select me was sort of give me a hug, and I just, it was a complete in tears at that time, and I think after that there was never a doubt of me getting selected. And for the next 4 years, I think I, for every tournament, I was selected, to the point where we went to Malaysia in 1987, I think 87 or 88. 88, it was just before the Olympics itself, was our final tournament. And
before then, you played at the World Cup in Willesden, didn't you?
For England.
For England,
yes.
That was England.
Right. That was England. I didn't really value that particular tournament. I don't value my medal as much as my bronze medal and the gold medal. Not because
Why is
it,
that?
I didn't participate a lot in that tournament. I think if you look back on the records, I probably played maybe an hour of total hockey in the whole tournament. So it was very disappointing for me. I was just ended up on the bench most of the time. And so when you don't participate, when you don't earn the medal, when you're not part of the earning the medal, then I suppose in my mind, I don't value that medal as much.
You understand that.
And so the World Cup, being at home as well, and you know, my sort of friends and family and everybody else, the expectation of me playing a tournament was sort of quite disappointing for me. So that's why I sort of very rarely talk about the World Cup, because it just wasn't a good experience for me.
The following year you went to Moscow for the European Cup.
Yes, yeah.
Was that England again?
That was England again. So Moscow was a very strange place in those days, still is. The whole experience of the tournament, sort of being monitored and staying in this sort of prison-like hotel, and the food was really awful, and to the point where we had so many chocolates and biscuits, we used to survive on those, to be honest with you. The food was really bad, and but anyhow, the tournament itself was quite a success. I think we ended up with the bronze medal, a silver medal, which should have been a gold, because I think we outplayed the Dutch in the final, and we had a chance to win. We had a penalty stroke, we missed that, and then we ended up losing on penalty strokes at the end. So that was sort of disappointing from that point of view, but nonetheless still quite a successful tournament in terms of medals.
And I understand there was a World 11 selected to play against Australia.
Yes.
Was that at the tournament or after?
That was after the tournament. What happened, I think there was a testimonial match for one of the Australian players, and they then selected a World 11 out of the five other nations who were there. And I was one of those players who got selected, and scored a goal, a winning goal as well.
That's a nice memory.
Yes. So that was quite a privilege to play with world's best players.
Who stood out in that team for you?
In the World 11 team, I think Stefan Blocher was playing centre forward. I mean, he I used to admire him because of his sort of, you know, the goal scoring ability. I was just a goal scoring machine at the time. And yeah, I mean, he was absolutely brilliant. And the Pakistani players, I mean, Samiullah and Salim, they were both brothers, one on the left wing, one on the right wing, and just mesmerizing type players. You could just watch them all day. They were just so, you know, graceful with their in the way they beat players, went around them, and it was Samuel's cross that went and deflected into the goal, which so they were just superb players. Loved playing with them. They was just so good. Yeah.
And then the following year was the Olympic year again in Seoul.
In Seoul, yeah.
Talking about going to Malaysia.
Yeah, so we went to it's a Six Nations tournament, and I think Richard Dodds didn't go. He had exams, I think medical exams, and so we the first night we had a meeting before the tournament started, and we sat around the table, and Roger Self appointed me as a captain for the tournament, which I nearly fell off the chair. Wasn't expecting that at all. There was no pre-warning or anything like that, and everybody kind of cheered in the room, which was so nice, you know, and yeah, there was so that was a very surprise position for me to lead the Great Britain team for that tournament. And it was a fantastic tournament from that point of view, but a very hostile place to play because of the environment. The humidity and the heat was just so severe that it's just I never experienced anything like that before. And but yeah, it was a really good tournament, and I think we ended up in a bronze medal position. Bronze or even silver. I really can't remember where we finished, but I think it was a good tournament for us.
Good preparation.
It was a very good preparation, yeah. And then obviously the Olympics was looming, so we trained very hard for that. We were sort of ranked, I think, number two in that tournament.
Yeah,
and so there was a lot of expectations. There was a lot of media sort of following our, you know, our path, if you like, and so that was a different experience. It put us under pressure from rather sort of just going into a tournament totally relaxed and with no pressure on, no expectations, and coming back with a medal. But here we were in the opposite sort of a situation where we were expected to get a medal, and we had a good tournament. We sort of, you know, we had one little bit of knockback against Germany in that tournament, but for some reason we never perform against Germany, but we did in the final. So that was yeah.
As far as many people back here are concerned, of course, that was when Sean Curley came to the fore. He became a household name.
Yes.
At that tournament.
Well, Sean had he was a strong, physically strong character. He had a tremendous running power. He had really superb shots on him, quite very accurate. And I guess he had players around him who fed him the right type of balls. And with Stephen Batchelor, Imran Sharwani, myself, were, you know, we delivered balls into the circle, which he was a master in finishing. And so I would give credit to Sean for, he became a household name because he scored most of the goals. and he was just phenomenal. He was just in top form at the time.
Yes.
Right, just right for us at the time.
Yes. Mm. But he's got to have the balls to do it.
Yes.
In more ways than one, but yes.
Yeah.
And then I've got down here, you didn't play against India.
In
Seoul.
No.
Was there a reason for that?
Who knows? Not that I know of. I don't know. I mean, I was so desperate to play. I always had my good games against India. I've scored. We played Willesden against India. I scored twice, and we played in Perth against India. I scored. So I was just surprised to be on the bench and didn't even get on, you know, as a substitute. And but no, I have not. You know,
maybe just rested.
Probably.
And when you came back, what was it like coming back with a gold medal?
Wow, that was some experience. It all started off with sort of us getting a first class seat on the 747 in the bubble, and I think it was the champagne all the way, and we were aware that there's going to be a TV crew, so I think we needed to be in a reasonable state to give interviews. I didn't fall out of the aeroplane onto the tarmac. It was just, you know, we didn't enjoy after winning the gold medal in Seoul, because there was nobody to celebrate it with. Yeah. So when we came back, and then our families and friends, and you know, they were all kind of waiting at the airport, and that's when we actually really appreciated that we have actually won the medal, you know. And when you got a lot of people around you and sort of congratulating you, and you have that. That's the sort of real emotional time, and I think that's when it hit us that we achieved something really great, so the press, and it was just.
You were all in demand for interviews and
yeah, absolutely.
Photo shoots and everything, weren't you?
Yeah, I mean, as you know, we were working full time, and I was working full time, and I went back to my work sort of 3 days later, and my office was all decorated with congratulations, Kulbir, Bhaura, welcome back, and with the medal, and they, my company held a special reception, all the directors and the chairman, you know, they sort of champagne, and so, you know, that was also unexpected, and I just hadn't appreciated it. I thought people just sort of come up and say, well, well done, guys. You know, but having to go back to a champagne reception for your company and office fully decorated like you would have at Christmas, it's just unbelievable. And it's sort of wherever we went, the clubs and families and friends, and so it was just, you know, there was a lot of appreciation, a lot of love for that.
We tend to forget that you were all working full-time as well.
Yes.
How easy was it to fit in all the training and all the matches and tournaments?
It wasn't easy. You know, we all held full-time jobs, or some of them, one or two of them were students, but we had to fit our training around the work. I used to get up sort of 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, and do my 1 hour, 1.5 hour training, and have a shower, go to work, and do a full day's work, and then leave office at 5:30, have a bite to eat, and then we're out again training in the evening. And that was a routine for a number of years.
Were you training with other members of the squad, or were you doing solo training?
It was solo training, because everybody lived so far away. The only time we got together was when we had the training weekends, training camps.
So what sort of training did you do?
Say in the morning, a typical session would be either I would go for a 5 mile run or 2 mile run, depending on, you know, how you felt, or would do a shuttle run or some description. I live next to a rugby club, in Australia, and so I just used literally fall out of bed and onto the pitch and do my runs and, you know, 100 meter sprints and that sort of stuff. So I would train sort of an hour to an hour and a half.
So this was all fitness training?
Fitness training,
not
yeah.
Skills training.
Yeah, because we didn't have access to AstroTurf pitches at that time. And so our club didn't have an AstroTurf pitch, so there were school pitches and they would normally be shut. You know, we didn't have access to them unless the pitches were booked. So the only time we actually got any sort of hockey skills work done was when we had our club training sessions in the on Tuesdays and Thursdays or at the weekends. And so most of the time it was just either going to the gym or running on the roads or on sort of hockey grass pitches. And in the winter, you know, it's 4 o'clock, it's dark and you can't play hockey and there was no floodlit facilities. So our training was, majority of the time was just physical, and so the technical training only came in when I had the opportunity to go onto the pitch on sort of an hour, a couple of hours a week, and that was it.
What happened after Seoul? Did you just go back to playing for South Middlesex and club?
After Seoul, the following season, the National League started, and an Indian Gymkhana, we qualified for the Premier Division, and I was captain, stroke coach for our first team, and we just played league hockey. I played league hockey till I was at the age of 40, so for the next 7 years, I played Gymkhana first team, and we finished in the National League, we finished in the top four for those 7 years. Second twice, we never won it, but we finished twice in the second position, and but always in the top four. Yeah, so that was a
very consistent.
Yeah, it was a good sort of achievement as far as the club was concerned.
So when you reached the grand old age of 40, did you face a decision on whether to drop yourself or retire?
I did. My final season at Christmas, just before Christmas, I can't remember who we were playing against, may have been Doncaster or someone like that. And I got ran ragged by a 20-year-old. And I was so frustrated in the match. And I came into the changing room after the match and I said to the boys, I said, guys, this is it. This is my last season. And next season, somebody else take over and I'm going to retire playing first team hockey. And that's exactly what I did. I didn't play for the first team after that. I started my business, my hockey retail and wholesale business. And so then I started focusing on my business commitments. So Saturday, being a hockey shop, on a Saturday was our main day.
Yes.
So I couldn't play hockey.
So did you think of playing vets, or did you play?
Yeah, I did play vets, but I didn't play over 40s. But I started when I was over 50. That's when I started playing for the vets. So I had 10 years out of hockey, not completely, but I was sort of keeping my, bit of training going and playing. I was taking him to the, he was five, and he started taking him to the, to the club. And then, as you always do, you get involved with your kids, coaching and that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So that's what I started doing. And then from 50 onwards, I played vets hockey.
Did you get into the Masters?
No, I just played for the club, for Indian Gymkhana. And I was asked many times to play Masters hockey for England and, you know, at every age group, but I just couldn't bring myself to play. My body's taken its toll and I just couldn't hold my body wouldn't hold up to yeah. tournament play or anything like that. Yes, the odd match, it was fine, but the knees and the back would suffer if I'd played more than sort of two or three games in a row, you know. Yeah, so it's not a... No.
Did you get involved in any administrative roles?
No. I did coach. Both Paul Barber and myself, we got involved straight after the Olympics. For 1 year, I was the coach and Paul Barber was the manager. We had the England shadow squad that we managed for about 12 months. And as both of us weren't qualified coaches, we hadn't done also level one or level two coaches, so there was a sort of a kind of a political decision to sort of sideline us because lots of qualified coaches weren't getting that position. The fact that Paul and I, between us, had nearly, I guess, 400 caps, that didn't matter. What mattered was having a level one badge. So
then you concentrated on your business.
Yeah.
And you developed your own, as you said, retail and
a wholesale
business. And then you owned Chingford Balls.
Yeah. Well, I started my business in 96, my retail shop. And then I took on the wholesale agency for Griffin Hockey, which is an Australian brand. And sort of progressed that, and I used to buy hockey balls from Chingford company itself for my retail and wholesale business, and the directors of that company were retiring, and so I, you know, they hinted that they wanted to sell the business, and I was in a position to negotiate the sale of that business, and I took over in 2003. And I ran that very successfully for about 10 years before the imports from India and China started. And at that point, we couldn't compete with the price. And so I had to then consider sort of closing the business, and I subsequently sold it to Grays in Pakistan. So they now own the machinery and manufacture.
But you kept the shop going.
So I ran the shop, had two shops, and so I ran those till about 3 years ago. And I think 2019, I sold the whole business, both retail and the wholesale business, and retired.
And yeah. Do you miss it?
I don't. I don't. No, I don't miss it. I think it was hard work. For 25 years, when you own a business and you're kind of responsible for lots of other people working for you, and it's a full-time commitment. You know, it's 7 days a week when it's your own business, and so no, I don't miss it.
So, what do you do for your time now? Do you watch hockey?
Very little. I still involved with the club. So I help out at the Indian Gymkhana with the sort of ran the junior section for a number of years, and I've just then I took a break through COVID, and I've just gone back into doing that again, and about two after Christmas I was taken on the responsibility for the first team, and coaching them again, and so I'm involved with the first team now again, and it's just keeping me sort of involved with hockey as opposed to sort of, yes, I watched the World Cup, I don't necessarily go to watch the live league matches or anything like that at the moment, no.
One of the other things we're often asked is, who was the best player you played with and who was the best player you played against?
Gosh. The best player I this person has been mentioned before. He is from where I learned my hockey, and his name is Dushan Singh Kula. He's a 1964 Olympic gold medalist for India. He's my idol that I have learned my hockey from. He used to play for United Brothers in the Midlands, and Bourneville as well. And he's probably 20 years senior to me. But he was absolutely a phenomenal player. His skills and his ability to sort of, and particularly on grass as well in those days, it was just unbelievable the way he used to sort of carry the ball and sort of the way he would beat players and give the ball to in absolute precision into the path of the players. And every time I played with him, I used to score like a hat trick. If I didn't score a hat trick, there was something wrong that day. I didn't perform well. And for me, he's been one of the best players that I have experienced playing with. And that's outside the international arena. Within the international arena, I guess people like Paul Barber has been superb. I mean, he's sort of underrated. I mean, he would score goals, give us vital goals at the right time. But his presence on the pitch was just quite phenomenal, and his distribution from the back, which never gets highlighted because it's always the goal scorers or the goalkeepers who get recognition. But I thought he used to be our backbone of the team for a number of years, and I rate him very highly.
And what about the best player you played against?
Rick Charlesworth. He was just absolute machine. His control, his running with the ball, was absolutely superb. I would say that his overall game, in terms of his distribution, his ability to beat players, ability to score goals, and you know, it was second to none. Say, yeah.
That's great. What about all the friends that you've made in hockey? Have you kept in touch with people you've played with throughout your career?
Not necessarily outside this country very well. I think the communication, we didn't really have the sort of communication we have now. And when you lose touch with players, and you never really sort of get that bond again, you know. So yes, there's lots of friends, lots of people that I've played against and got to know outside hockey as well over the years in various countries. But keeping in touch, it just isn't there. But in this country, yeah, I mean, I sort of, you know, wherever I go, I always bump into people, and you go to a tournament and it's amazing how many people you actually meet and that you recognize, that you played against or you played with, or, you know, just simply people have watched you over the years and they come up to you, they say, oh, I watched you at the Olympics, or I watched you in the World Cup, or I watched you at Wimbledon. You know, it's so that's a really nice feeling. Is you're never alone at a tournament. Even if I go alone, you're always with friends. There's always somebody that you end up sitting next to or chatting with and or spending time with. Yeah.
And is there a one standout memory that you always hold with you from your hockey playing group?
Gosh. Well, it has to be the winning. Of the medal, for me, the bronze medal has more value. It's a funny thing to say, but I hold my bronze medal very dear because of the struggle to achieve that. And so for me, I would say that moment when I cried on Roger Self's shoulders, that is a standout moment for me, emotionally and also in terms of achievement. So that would be what I really felt at the time. Yeah.
That's great. Is there anything we've missed going through your cantering through your career?
I don't think so. I think we covered.
Okay.
Yeah.
In that case, Kulbir, thank you very much for talking to me and for sharing all your memories from a fantastic career.
Thank you.
I did enjoy watching you.
thank you.
I'm sure I'm not alone in that. There's many, many others who did too. So thank you very much indeed for that.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.